this past week. I had several things I had to do, but one of those was I had to go out of town, Sharon and I did, to Bowling Green, Kentucky. And on the drive, we were listening to 94.1 The Fish because our ads for the concert are on The Fish, and I wanted to hear the ads. And the truth is, I started listening to the praise music that was on The Fish, and I heard all these songs. Lee, turn around. Come over here. I'm telling this story, but it's a compliment to you. And I heard, I was going to Bowling Green, Kentucky, you see. And I was listening to 94.1 because I wanted to listen to the ads. And I never hear them because I always get up there at the wrong time. We gave some tickets for a giveaway. I missed that. And I'm always writing the notes like, I didn't hear this. And they're like, well, it ran at this time. And I was listening to the praise music. And I told Sharon, I said, we sing that. We do that better than they're doing it on the radio. And I just want you to know that. And my wife said, that's Lee, you know. And I said, I know. And I said, I just want you to know, and I want to say this in front of everybody, we are so blessed to have you. And we're so appreciative of you. Okay? You probably won't get a raise for 5 years, but I'm going to compliment you so much. Thank you. God bless you. I mean that too, I really do. You ever have anybody do that to you? You know, be very nice to you and say, yeah, you didn't get the promotion, I'm sorry. But I just want to tell you, I love this church. And I want to tell you, you are incredible and wonderful people. Every week, I have 2 to 3 encounters with people who say, my heart has been touched or my life has been transformed by this church. And I'm not talking about the worship or I'm talking about being transformed by being in your midst. I was talking to a couple the other night on the phone that their lives were just going out of control. And they came here and Kelly Brenizer and some other people wrapped their arms around this couple and their family. And they have come to know Christ in a different way, and their lives are coming together. They've watched God do some miracles in their lives, and they are just praising God for you. I watched a young man. I hope you enjoyed William Cheney last Sunday. A 6-year-old boy responding to God through William Cheney. Wrote him a note, and William showed me the note. He said, "I'm framing this, man. I'm framing this." And I've just, again, 2 to 3 times a week, I hear that. And I'm just so appreciative of that. That doesn't happen. God is here. And God is faithful. And God is using you. And I just want to say to you that I'm very appreciative just to be a part of all this. And I just know that God, and I pray that God will touch your life today as we talk. Because we are in the business of helping people experience the power of God through the Holy Spirit. Amen? We want people to be able to respond to God and be transformed by God. Amen? And really, many times, the person who needs it most is not to the person to your left or to your right or the person behind you or the person in front of you. It's you. And I want you to understand that's okay. We don't have to be stressed out that we don't have it together. We just don't. We need God desperately. And I believe you understand that and know that. And I just want to thank you for that. Because that's the thing that I believe was set in place 20 years ago and has never changed. Is that we want lives to be challenged. We want lives to be transformed by Jesus Christ. And I see that. And I want to tell you that it's a privilege for me. So could we go to the Lord in prayer before we begin today? Lord, I just want to thank you so much for fellowship. Lord, I want to thank you for the opportunity to be the pastor here. There's a lot that you want to teach me through all of these people. You know, there have been times when I thought, well, I'm here to show this or here to do this. And Lord, you reminded me day by day, I'm not here to do anything but listen and learn and obey. So Lord, thank you for that. Thank you for that privilege for me. And I thank you for the privilege we have to be together and be a community and learn what it means to be a family. I thank you, Lord, that we can lift you up over these weeks of these I am statements, and that as we lift you up, that literally your words say, as we glorify you and lift you up, we are transformed by putting our focus there. Lord, I pray that these messages will not just be information, but Lord, I pray that you will use these messages to touch hearts and to transform lives, that it's not that it's you, Lord, that you're speaking into the lives and the hearts of people. Lord, I just thank you again for these incredible people here and who they are. I'm so blessed to be a part of it, and I pray your blessings upon this community in the weeks, days, months, and years ahead. And I pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. My daddy was a banker. He's in heaven now. My granddaddy was a banker. And my great-granddaddy was a banker. Small town bankers. Little banks. One bank. In a little town. And it opened. Do you remember when the banks used to open up from 9 o'clock to 2 o'clock? And maybe you don't. Well, that's what ours opened up and closed. And the reason it did, because in this little town, the town revolved around the ranchers and the farmers when they would come into town. When the bank would open up. So when the bank was open, the ranchers and the farmers were there, the grocery stores were open, and everything happened downtown. After 2 o'clock, it looked like the whole downtown was a ghost town because everybody had already been there. They had done their work. I'm the only son in the family, and my job was to be the fourth generation, and God screwed that up. He did. I was going to study finance at Baylor University. I did study finance and didn't do well at all. You know, accounting is hard. I hated that class. I was chastising my daughter, not chastising, but one of our daughters struggles with math and da-da, you know, and I'm like, well, you know, you need to do this or do that. I'm not going to show her my grades in finance and accounting, you know. The truth is I was horrible at it. In fact, if I had not majored in marketing, I would have not gotten a degree. The reality is that I was going to be a banker because that's what my daddy was and his daddy, and that's what we did. You know, in Jesus' time, that's exactly what you did. You did what your daddy did. And whether you were a fisherman or whether you were a carpenter, whatever it was, you did what your daddy did. And today, as we look at this passage in John 14, 1 through 6, we are in the fourth week of a seven-week series on the I am statements of Jesus Christ. As we look at the context of our scripture today, these men who followed Jesus have given up their livelihoods. They're not going to follow their daddies anymore. They're going to follow Jesus. And they have sacrificed in their minds everything. And this statement, this I am statement I'm going to read to you in just a moment, is made within 48 hours of Jesus dying on the cross, Jesus being sacrificed for you and me. And when Jesus makes this I am statement I'm about to talk to you about, he's already said to the disciples, one of you is going to betray me. Which, by the way, adds a little bit of tension in the room. Just a little bit. And so there's tension and there's confusion in the room. 48 hours before he's to die. And Jesus looks at the disciples and says these words, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way?" And Jesus said this. Read this with me. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. May God add his blessing, his power, and his hope to the reading of his holy word. The disciples are freaking out. And Jesus, in a sense, is very kind because he says, you know, if you go back to that first, he says, do not be troubled. Now, I just want you to know, in my mind, I would be a little bit frustrated. Now, he has already said something that escalates the tension when he says, you know, one of you is going to betray me. But what is amazing, I think, to Jesus, and I would have reacted differently in my mind because I'm human, I think Jesus is a little bit frustrated that they are freaking out at the level they are. I mean, if I was them, if I'm insecure at times and when somebody challenges me on something, do you ever do this? I give them a verbal resume. Yeah, well, let me tell you what I've done. And then you go through this verbal resume trying to calm things down, and all it does is make you look arrogant. I mean, it really is not, doesn't help at all. If I was Jesus, I would have said, look, guys, stop freaking out. Do you remember Lazarus? You know, the guy who was dead? I raised him to life. Do you remember that? Do you remember the storm? I mean, y'all were all freaking out in the boat. Do you remember that? And I was asleep. And then you woke me up. And what did I do? I spoke into the storm. And what happened? It calmed down. And did you remember those 15,000 people that showed up on the side of that hill? Largest crowd I ever had. And they got hungry and you were all freaking out like you're doing right now. And I took that boy's lunch, that little boy's lunch, and I fed everybody. Let not your hearts be troubled. That's what I would have done. I would have kind of chastised him a little bit, but he doesn't. He just says, you know, let not your hearts be troubled. He's wanting them to see who he really is in this moment. It's interesting. He sees Thomas in verse 5, it says, said to him, let's go to verse 5. Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Again, these guys have given everything for Jesus. They've been following him for 3 years. He's 48 hours from dying. They don't know that. But they also know that he's also said somebody's going to betray him, and they're confused. And then I love Thomas. And we give Thomas a hard time. We call him Doubting Thomas. Man, I'm Thomas. You're Thomas. Thomas is the most human guy in the whole bit. And he says to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? He's like, hold on, man. You told us you were going to build a kingdom. Now, in their minds, that kingdom was the Old Testament kingdom that was promised. It was also in their minds that I believe they thought that he was going to overthrow the Roman government, that he was going to release them from the oppression. Of course, that's not what he was saying at all. But Thomas is sitting there saying, man, I left my dad, I left my career, I left everything, and now this guy is telling us that in a little while he's going to be gone, he's going to leave us. What the heck are you doing, Jesus? Where are we going to go? I don't have any place to go. That's what he's saying. He's saying, man, I don't have any place to go, man. I bet everything on you. And here you are talking about leaving? No, you're not. That's what I would have said. You're not leaving this place. And at a deeper sense, and I want you to hear this, at a deeper spiritual sense, what Jesus promised them was that he was going to show them the way home. Do you hear what I'm saying? We all are on a journey home. And that journey for me into Texas, and that journey for you isn't to Murfreesboro or Tennessee or Virginia or Mississippi or somewhere else. That's home in the physical sense. We're all on a journey home. We're all looking for home. And Jesus was showing them the way. And then all of a sudden, the GPS goes crazy and says, GPS shutting down, GPS shutting down, and they start freaking out. And Thomas has the integrity and the genuine. I love his authenticity to say, look, man, you talked in all these riddles and we didn't get those and we thought that was okay because you did these miracles, but now this is serious. By the way, you're not real popular right now either. And I don't understand. How do we get home now? How do we get home? Do you hear what I'm saying? That in his spirit, I believe what he's, at his depth is what he's asking is, how do I get home? And then Jesus answered him, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes through the Father but through me. And my outline this morning is very simple. I just want to take a few minutes talking about Jesus being the way, the truth, and the life. And then I want to open up these altars and allow you an opportunity to respond however God touches your heart. The first way is this. Jesus is the way. Please understand that there is a chasm between you and God. And the chasm between you and God is not your career. The chasm between you and God is not your money. It's not your house. It's not relationships. The chasm between you and God is sin and death. Now, we don't like talking in that language in our world today. We like saying other words. But the reality is what separates us from God is sin and death. And Jesus Christ fills the chasm of that gap with his life. He is the bridge. And when he talks about being the way, he goes, I go to prepare a place for you. That place is really something that's relational. He's not talking about building some big mansion in heaven. What he's talking about is being in communion with God. He's talking about being in relationship with God. He is the way to relationship with God. When he says, I am the way, what he's saying is, I am going to be the bridge. I am going to be the one who lays down my life, and through my life, you're going to be able to come into relationship with God. So many of us have questions in our lives. Lord, should I do this? Should I do that? Should I go here? Should I go there? Should I buy this or buy that? Should I date so-and-so or so-and-so? Should I get married? Should I not? Should we have kids? Should we not? Should I take this health procedure? And many of us are looking for answers. The problem is, for many of us, we're caring more about the answers than we are about God. And what I want you to know is, if you want to know what the destination of your life is, every time, and you don't want to know what the answer is, every time, the answer is God. Because he is the destination for everything. For many of us, what ends up happening is we spend all our time freaking out about decisions we need to make and not go to the answer that's always there, which is God. I've done that. Lord, should I move here? Should I move there? And God's like, move wherever. I don't care because you're not in communion with me and you don't care what I think, so just do what you need to do. Wow. The reality is we care more about a decision than we do God. And what he's saying here, when he says, I am the way, he's saying, I am the bridge. I bridge the gap of the chasm between you and God. And I am the way you will come into into relationship with God. And when he says, I go and prepare a place, he's saying, I'm preparing myself for what's about to happen here. He doesn't have he's not a carpenter going up starting to build a 10 by 10 room for you. He's saying, I'm preparing for what is about to happen to me. Because, gentlemen, I'm about to get slaughtered. And because of that, because I'm going to absorb the sin that was meant for you, you can believe, you can be in relationship with God. I am the way. He goes on to say, I am the truth. I am the way. He is the bridge. He prepares a place for us, and that place is not a mansion. That place is a relationship with God. And He is the truth. He is the self-disclosure of God Himself. Colossians 1 says that Jesus is the image of the invisible God. You know, we can know what God looks like. Just look at Jesus. Jesus is God. Again, Colossians says He is the image of the invisible God. And if you want to know who God is and you want to know how God feels about you, look at Jesus. And what you will see is stunning grace, stunning mercy. I think we separate Jesus and God and think that God thinks one way about us and Jesus thinks the other. They're one and the same. God loves you. God has grace and mercy for you. And Jesus is the truth of God because He is righteousness. He is righteousness. And what I'm going to do for the rest of our time, I'm just going to talk to you about how we tend to mess up this whole idea of righteousness. And what I mean by that is Jesus is righteousness, but for so many of us, we live in this performance-oriented society. We want to be righteous. And we're not. We're self-righteous, but we're not righteous. And do you know what we do in order to kind of say to God, you know, hey, I'm kind of righteous? We compare ourselves to others. My kids, you know, they would do something wrong and I'd be getting on them. And they'd say, well, at least I'm not in prison. You know, they're 15, you know. Well, at least I didn't murder anybody. You know, I haven't done your homework in 2 weeks and you're making zeros and we're totally ticked off. And they're like, well, at least I'm not an axe murderer. Do you know we do the same exact thing? The way that I prove my righteousness is I compare myself to others. At least I'm not like Sean. Amen. Wow, everybody uses you, Sean. I mean, I'm serious. We sit there and say, you know, at least I'm not like Susan. We do. And we say to God, in a sense, hey, look, I'm righteous, and I'm righteous not by your standard, God, because there's no way I'm righteous in that way. I'm righteous because so-and-so over here. I'm better than Lee. No, I'm not. We all know it, too. The reality is he's the truth, and He is the truth because He is the righteousness of God. He is the righteousness of God, and that is our truth. That is the standard. And we don't need to compare ourselves or throw somebody under the bus. And by the way, Sean, I love you, man. I do, and I can kid you. And so thank you very much. All right, thank you. Good, good. If y'all see Sean, you'll know. If you've never seen him, look at his arms. His arms are bigger than my legs, so I should really pick on somebody a lot smaller. But the truth is that Jesus is the righteousness of God. He is not only the way, He is the truth. And the final thing is, He's the life. Here in this passage, in John, He says this, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you with me, that you may also be where I am. I'm going to prepare a place for you, and I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. So He says this, He goes, look, guys, I'm leaving. I'm going to prepare a place for you, but I'm going to come back. Guess what He's insinuating? There's a gap. There's a gap between when he's leaving and when he's coming back. There's a gap between he's leaving and when he's coming back. And for you and I really see that as when we receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and when we go to heaven. There's a gap. There's a gap from the moment we receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and when we go to heaven. And what he's saying here is, I want you to have life in that gap. He's talking about life now. It's not just life in the hereafter. To me, if everything was meant in the to be in heaven, and if life was just to be meant in heaven, then for some reason, somehow, I think God would have worked it out that as soon as we receive Jesus Christ, we just would get sucked out of this world. And there goes, see? I got sucked off my ear. We get just gone. But the reality is, that doesn't happen, does it? If God's intention is that real life was in heaven, then why are we left here on earth once we receive Jesus Christ? It's because God has a plan for us, an incredible plan to be conduits of God's love and God's grace. Because God doesn't want you just to go home and be with Him. God wants everyone to go home and be with Him. Amen? And so He has a purpose for our lives, a purpose to shine His grace and His mercy and His life. And His amazing power. But you know the only way that can happen? The only way for us to really reflect truly God's love and God's grace is that we go back to this whole idea of righteousness, that we stop trying to fake righteousness and we really own the fact that we are broken people. You see, I think for some of us, we really don't receive the righteousness of God, but we try to produce our own righteousness. We try to produce our own sense of perfection, that we've got it all together, that we know what we're doing, that we're deep with God. Now, I'm not going to ask you to raise hands, and I really debated about doing that today, but has anybody here ever in your life thought, oh my gosh, people are going to find out that I'm a fraud, that I'm a fake, that I'm really not the kind of person they think I am? Just let me raise mine, because I have those thoughts. If you have those thoughts, if you have that in your quiet moments, if you think, oh man, people think I'm this kind of parent, they think I'm this kind of husband, they think I'm this kind of person, they think I'm this kind of Christian, and if when they find out that I'm a fraud, that I'm a hypocrite and I'm a fake, what's going to happen? If you ever feel that way, then you are depending on your own righteousness and not God's. If you want to know if you depend on your own righteousness, if you ever had that thought, then I'm telling you, you are. And I've had that thought. Because sometimes ministers mess up and think that we're the model. I love the fact that I can be a confessional preacher. And I love the fact that I can be honest, because it is not my righteousness I want you to have. Thank the Lord. It is the righteousness of God that I want you to have. I am broken, and I do hypocritical things, and I struggle just like you. And I don't think that revival or that God breaks out in environments that are not authentic and confessional. But where people are honest and where people are real and where people say, I need God, God breaks out in an incredible way. And the reason He does is because we're not seeking our own righteousness. We're seeking the righteousness of God. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. And Jesus is the life. And we begin to have life when we confess the reality that we don't have it together and we're free from the slavery of perfection, the slavery of being self-righteous. We don't have to do that anymore. We're free from that. Let me close with this and then we'll come and pray. This happened in the 1970s. And I believe it's a true story. It's a great story. But I actually believe it's true. I saw it in several devotional books that mentioned that it was. It happened on a Saturday night in Chicago about 1 a.m. Dr. Leo Winters was a great surgeon in that city. And like I said, it was about the early 70s, and he got a call that a little boy had been in an accident and that his body had been mangled and it was bad. And the doctors that were there at the emergency room got together and they said, we're going to have to go into surgery pretty quickly here, but we've got to have somebody. We got to have the best in the city. And that person was Dr. Leo Winters. They called him at his house at 1 a.m. and they said, we need you here at the hospital. He got on his clothes. He got to his car. He had a decision to make. Between his house and the hospital was a real dangerous part of Chicago. And if he took his normal route around that dangerous part, it was going to take a lot longer. The time was of the essence. And so he said, I'm going to have to go through this dangerous part of Chicago in order to get to the hospital and save this little boy's life. And so about, you know, not too long after he got that phone call at 1 a.m. in the morning, he drives through this dangerous part of town. He gets to the first intersection. He makes it through the first intersection, the second intersection of this area. He gets to the third and a stoplight goes. And he stops. And a man with a gray hat and an old flannel shirt is running at his car. And before he could get the car locked, the man opens the door and says, get out of this car now. I need it. He grabs the doctor. He throws him to the street. The man gets in the car and drives off. Doctor stunned. Takes him 45 minutes, again, early 70s, before he can find a phone and call a taxi. Taxi comes and gets him. He arrives at the hospital an hour after he was supposed to. And the nurse looks at him and says, Doctor, I'm sorry. The little boy has died. She said, and by the way, his dad got here right before he passed away. And his dad's in the chapel. And he's angry. And he wants to know why you weren't here. And so the doctor walked to the chapel. And can you imagine that walk? And he goes into the chapel. And he can't believe his eyes as he looks. And kneeling there at the altar is a man with a gray hat and a dirty flannel shirt who's praying at the altar. The man gets up, turns around, and is shocked to see the very person that he had stolen his car. You see, that man who took that car that night from that doctor pushed away the one person who could save his son's life. And ladies and gentlemen, we do that same thing with God. We push him away and say, I got this. We push him away and say, we put ourselves before God. And on that night that Jesus was talking to the disciples, when they were freaking out, they were putting themselves and thinking about what's going to happen to me, what's going to happen to here. They didn't put their trust in Jesus Christ. They didn't put their trust in God. They put their trust in their circumstances. They put their trust in their doubt, in their confusion. And in that moment, they pulled away from God. And they pulled away from the very person who could save their life. And you and I do that same thing. This morning, I just want to, as we go to prayer, as we come to the time of respond, I just want to say to you that this is an opportunity for us to say, Lord, you are the way, you are the truth, and you are the life. I trust in you as the bridge between me and God. I understand that the destination for all of life, Lord, is God, and I want to be in communion with him. I also understand, Lord, that I've been living on my own righteousness too long and that I need to trust in you, realizing that I am broken, that I am hypocritical, that I am in need. I am broken and I am in need of not only your healing, but I'm in need of your righteousness in my life. Because if I'm to stand before God and have any chance at all, it won't be because of anything I've done, because Isaiah says that our righteousness in God's eyes, our deeds of righteousness are like filthy rags. It's only through Jesus Christ. And Lord, I want to live life in the gap now, and live life and live it abundantly in you. Let's pray. Jesus, you are the way. You are the truth. And you are the life. We look for so many other things to be the way. We look for so many sources to be the truth. And we look for so many things to be the life. But Lord, ultimately, it is you. Lord, let us confess our need for you today in every area of our life. Let us not hold up our own righteousness, but let us hold up our own brokenness and our need for you, and let us receive and trust in you and free us from the slavery of perfection, of trying to work ourselves into your kingdom. Lord, I thank you for who you are and that you are the way, the truth, and the life. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite you to come now as we respond to God.